Test Tank 17 has been lifted into the structural test stand at Massey's. More boosted quick disconnect clues at Sanchez. The main entrance to the ring yard has been permanently cut off in preparation for the Gigabay project at the build site. And the launch mount is sitting on its legs at the launch site. Hey everyone, and welcome to RGV Aerial Photography's Starbase Flyover update number 84. This week's flyover was on May 16th at an altitude of 10,500 feet, with perfect weather to capture all the new developments at Starbase Texas. My name's Jeff A, and I'll be your guide today. So let's first head over to the Massey's test facility. Here's a map of the site made by Proky to help you find your way around. Let's begin at the structural test stand. We can see Test Tank 17 is now in the stand. At the bottom of the stand, there are two new control panels. Near the top of the tank, a vent for the lower tank is connected to the valve sled on the test stand. Next, let's move to the booster cryo stand. Installation of the hold down arms has begun, with three in the stand and four near the pedestals, with one hooked to the crane. Plates with curved T-bars have also been installed between each clamp location. Similar to other test stands, these support the vehicle's aft section between the clamps. At the new booster QD frame, we can see that the decking has been installed to allow workers to easily work and access both quick disconnects. Before we move to Sanchez, let's check in on the progress at Rio West. As always, framing and second level construction continues at the top and bottom of the site. In the middle of the site, framing on the apartments is well underway, as well as foundation work and garage formwork continuing. Roadways have been poured around the site, with a pour underway as of this flyover. At the apartment buildings next to the community building, sheathing has been installed ahead of siding work for the buildings. Moving further along Highway 4, the newest lot being cleared has grown. This is the site of the new Ad Astra school. The tiny home lot a little further yet continues to get organised as the homes are placed, with at least one new unit arriving this week. In the back left corner of the site, water tanks are being installed, with three new tanks arriving by truck during the flyover. As we make our way east, a quick look at the Highway 4 lot sees the return of boom segments for the SpaceX LR11000 following off-site repairs. Let's move on to Sanchez, shall we? Starting at the former OLM area, work on booster QDs has started, with tents for welding set up. To the side, the possible quick disconnect liquid oxygen and methane fill and drain valve structure is progressing, with more piping getting integrated. These two sets of pipes should be for filling and draining, using both for a faster loading and unloading process. These would be placed on the gantry ground floor on May 18th. At the Star Factory workstand construction area, the boosted transport stand has the remaining arm actuators installed. To the side, several Block 3 hold down clamps are staged. Moving past the clamp arms, the suspected ship workstand from last week has been moved away, with another matching stand being assembled. Just across the drive, two mystery items have been delivered. Their shape suggests they may be installed in the launch mount over one of the water manifolds, potentially related to one or both of the boosted quick disconnects. Let us know your thoughts in the comments. Further along the front of the site, the stand with the triangular base has been flipped right side up. The first of three walkway segments has been installed. Earlier in the day, three additional leg assemblies were spotted en route to Starbase for another to be assembled soon. Trucks are staged nearby. One has two pump motors for the Pad B methane farm. Just in front are two trucks with several items wrapped in white plastic. Looking at their shapes, they appear to form the circular base of a possible workstation. Some new big metal pieces have arrived. They are possibly outer shielding for Pad B's gantry, but we'll have to keep an eye on them to see what their actual purpose is. More launch mount hold down arms were delivered and waiting to be moved to the pad for installation into the OLM structure. Moving to the rocket garden, a booster transport stand is parked after delivering booster 14-2 to the launch site. Shortly after the flyover, it would be taken back to the launch site, but more on that later. To the side, scaffolding has been set up in booster 12's transport stand. We don't currently know why, but we'll keep an eye on it. Finally, trench work and drainage culvert placement continues at Remedios Avenue, getting the road ready for shorter transport of vehicles in the not too distant future. Just before moving to the build site, we'd like to thank all of our YouTube and Patreon members. Keep in mind, all of the patrons get to participate in our show and tell sessions on the same day of each flight. Here, you can join in discussions and ask your own questions. YouTube members also get to watch and listen in with a live chat function. Let's have a quick look at the map to get you familiar with the site. Please feel free to use the pause function for an extended view. Starting off at Megabay 2, let's refer to this La Padre footage showing a Raptor 2 engine leaving the bay on May 15th, after Ship 35 was rolled back from its static fire at Massey's. Could this be a sign that an engine underperformed, as some unsubstantiated rumours have claimed? Continuing with another clip from La Padre, we can see the first LOX barrel section for Ship 38 has been moved into the bay. This makes the ship 13 rings tall out of 21. Booster 18's common dome section was rolled into Megabay 1 on May the 19th. As these new parts roll across the ring yard, we should start to see some of the upgrades to the version 3 airframe. The most notable item on this barrel section is it's only a triple instead of the normal quad. The dome is also located differently within the barrel ring. There is a bunch of speculation as to whether it's part of a stretch block 3 booster or just a change in the LOX to methane proportions. Less notable is the stringer count and spacing of the vents. With the door once again being opened during our flyover, we can see some more progress with the upgrades to the left-hand turntable that is used for stacking the LOX tank sections onto the booster aft section. Outside, we can see some new style clamps staged for this turntable. As seen in this image from Starbase Surfer, parties were hosted on two consecutive nights the past week to celebrate the marriage of a SpaceX engineer. Congratulations to all! Over at the High Bay, deconstruction continues this week as the footprint of the future Giga Bay is starting to take shape. Let us know if you think Giga Bay will further expand to have a direct connection to the Star Factory in the comments. We can expect to see piles being drilled in the bay's foundations in the coming weeks, so stay tuned! Moving over to the Star Factory area, we can see the forward flap and aft flaps for ships 36 and 37 removed from the racks that are getting painted white. This could indicate that they will be moved inside the Star Factory. We speculate that the operations that were in the first section of Star Factory are being moved over to the new areas. This will allow the bakery, also known as Tent 4, and inventory like the flaps rack to be moved inside. Now taking a look at Boca Chica Village, a three-story apartment building has had major progress with its foundations, with its CFA pilings completed and the drilling rig leaving the day before this photo was taken. Before moving on to the launch site, quick reminder to give this video a like if you learned something new so far. Also, we're targeting 70,000 subscribers by the end of summer, so please subscribe if you haven't already to see more exclusive content from RGV Aerial. Check out this week's labelled map. The Pad B launch mount is in place and Pad A has a booster. Starting at Pad B, the launch mount is in place. As expected, the first manifold installed in Sanchez is now over the GSE gantry. The southern corner of the mount is covered while welders connect the two manifolds together with an elbow. Atop the mount, several strips of steel were lifted. These should fill the gap between the launch mount deck and the water manifold. The trench walls have made further progress this week. Concrete has been poured in the lower section to level the top surface. All four of the upper slopes are assembled, with the slope surface covered in steel panels to allow the cavities to be filled with concrete soon. To the west of the gantry, four additional plates are staged for installation once the slopes are filled. Behind the gantry, the three vaults and foundation pad have been poured. For additional strength, they have been poured in a single cast assembly. Turning to the tower, chopstick load testing has begun. Here, four 100-ton capacity water bags have been suspended from the chopstick load spreader. Just below, the large black hose running from the Pad A deluge area has been extended here, likely to fill the bags. A quick look at the pump, we can see it is connected to one of the water tanks as well as pooling from the retention pond. Returning to Pad B, here you can see the crates for the bags and support rigging. Observations from the ground indicate a different testing plan for this tower. Bags with 100 tons, 50 tons and 35 ton capacities have been seen totaling a possible 910 tons of testing weight. To the north of the tower, another concrete pad has been prepared. This spans over part of the commodity culvert and a thicker slab to carry any load to each side of it. Adjacent, further progress is seen in the high-pressure pipes to the tower, with the entire trench excavated and pipes now running the full length. Moving to the deluge tank farm, the CFA drill rig continues to place new piles along the tanks. To the north of the farm, two tankers can be seen offloading at the vertical tanks. This week marked the first observations of such deliveries. Work near the two excavations north of the smaller tanks have seen new activity. The eastern pit has a new pipe placed in it, with a second pipe assembly nearby with the same shape being fabricated, possibly for the second pit. Across the D2 entrance, the Pad B pump farm continues to be outfitted. All six pumps at the lock side now have pump motors. The methane pumps are largely the same this week. The first two pump motors can be seen installed as previously mentioned. Additional motors were once again installed following the flyover. The LN2 exhaust systems for the methane subcoolers have been plumbed. Each manifold connects to an additional manifold system using three valves to control the flow which exits through the vertical vent pipe. The system regulates the rate of evaporation of the nitrogen inside the subcoolers, much like on the methane pump farm for Pad A. This in turn regulates the temperature of the methane delivered to the ship and booster. Moving to the front of the farm, rebar has been prepared to cover the area in concrete now that underground work is complete. Near the LOX pumps, the first of the six large vaporizers damaged during Flight 8 has returned. The unit has additional cross bracing on the lower section. We will have to watch for signs of any further reinforcement to prevent damage from future launches. Many lengths of electrical cable can also be seen here, which has been pulled toward the east with a directional drill near the tanker offload area. Further integration work on the newest methane tanks continue with smaller pipes in the rack, aside one tank, now bridging the racks along the front of the farm. We finish this week's tour with Booster 14-2 still sitting atop the Pad A launch mount. It seemed always looking ready for the booster to remain until Flight 9. The stabilizer arms for the launch mount had already been removed with the access hole cover welded closed. The launch mount ring was also clear of all scaffolding. But this would ultimately come to pass. The booster transport stand had already left the launch site but made a return on May 17th, with the booster being lifted off the launch mount for its return to Megabay 1. It's unclear at this time what the problem may be, however nav warnings for the Gulf and the Indian Ocean have recently been pushed back to May 27th, indicating a delay in the next launch. News also broke before the flyover with the release of the Flight 9 launch license. It was issued on May 15th, though the FAA indicated that SpaceX had submitted its mishap report on May 14th. While the license has been approved, the mishap report for Flight 8 needs to be closed or a return to flight determination must be made by the FAA. The launch license only had a few changes. Many of them added language because of the final tiered environmental assessment that was also released last week for increased launch cadence. The FAA released this with a FONSI, or finding of no significant impact, allowing up to 25 launches from the Starbase launch complex. The most notable item in the launch license was the removal of the launch site as a potential destination for a Flight 9 vehicle. While it's uncertain, the document might suggest that Booster 14-2 might be destined for a soft water landing in the Gulf, as paragraph 14b3 authorises flights to the Gulf of America and Indian Ocean locations specified in its application, having removed the launch complex from that line. And with that news, that's it for episode 84 of Starbase Flyover Update. Thanks for choosing to fly with RGV Aerial Photography, and we hope you all enjoyed the flight. If you liked what you saw today, please subscribe for more episodes and content so you don't miss out on the new videos each week. I'm Jeff A, and we hope to see you again from 10,500 feet.